episode 70.
Viva Physical Media, episode 7070.
Seven decades, seven bells. We made it.
We did it.
We made it to 2024.
We made it. Like, we made it, but then we made it.
If you're watching this right now, just know.
You made it with us.
That you came out on the other side.
We all made it together.
We made it. Everything you've been through, you've been through.
Mm-hmm. Whatever happened, happened.
Yep, and here we are. And it's been a good one so far.
It's been a good one. You know, the big news is we hit our fundraising goal.
We, incredibly, with the help of everyone out there.
All of you watching, and many other folks as well.
Hit our
massive fundraising goal of $150,000.
Millions of dollars. We hit it. We made it. And that's amazing.
That's very good. That will help Scarecrow flourish and thrive in the new year.
Going into the new year with just a fat stack of bills.
Well, I mean,
I don't have that though.
Let's not exaggerate. It's what,
we needed to keep going.
Yeah.
We feel good going into the new year. And we're very thankful if you made a donation or if you support us in any way, if you even just watch the show or rent a movie every now and then, we thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you.
Oh, thank you. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
You might notice that behind us is no longer the Christmas section.
It's the best of 2023.
It's the best of 2023 section. And it's only going to get bigger and beefier as the days go on. If you are in the area and want to stop by the store, make a beeline for the stuff back here. Also, it's cool because usually our new releases are only two-day rentals. But if you find a new release back here, you get it for a week. A little life hack. What was our top? We should list our top.
Oh, our top five? Is it
up there?
Number one. John Wick, Chapter 4.
Number 2, Prey.
Which finally came out on physical media despite being a streaming-only release when it came out.
Oh.
Yeah.
I still haven't seen it.
Number 3, Infinity Pool.
Love it. Number 4, Barbie.
Everyone knows Barbie. And then number 5, Sick of Myself, which I still haven't seen.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
Well,
I heard it's good.
We all like it. We all like it here.
It was John Waters' favorite movie of last year.
Oh, nice. Mm. Well, good for
that
him.
Makes sense.
He's a funny old gentleman.
I respect that man's opinion.
Yeah, I've been to his house.
Wait, you've been to his house?
More than once.
You've been to his house or have you walked by it?
No, I've been inside it.
Why?
He used to live in Baltimore. He was a nice man.
And he just would be like, hey, Matt, come in my house?
Well, no, it didn't really work out that way, but...
You broke into his house.
Yes, I broke into his house. No, I've been in his house. I'm just saying I've been in his house.
That's all he'll say, folks.
Anyway.
And if you want to know more...
It'll be a $100,000 donation to Scarecrow. It'll be a $100,000
donation to Scarecrow video. Yeah, you know what else is fun? To email us at viva@scarecrow.com.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
You can do that and tell us what you're about to watch. Do you have any, like, plans for movies in 2024? Any movie resolutions?
So my hope for 2024 is the last couple of years. First of all, I've been sort of, like, recalculating the sphere of my life.
As a whole, not just your movie life.
Not just my movie life, but my life primarily revolves around movies, so that's a big part of it.
Mm-hmm.
And so the last couple of years, I've been sort of like taking a lot of time off from movies.
Yeah, I know you said you were kind of in a rut for a while.
I've been in a rut. I also, like, because of the show, because of our podcast, I don't have a lot of time to watch stuff that is purely for pleasure.
Mm-hmm.
And when I do have time to watch things for pleasure, I tend to, like, retreat into comfort food, stuff I've seen a bunch of times, things I own already, things like that.
Yeah.
So my New Year's movie resolution is to try to dig up more old stuff, stuff I haven't seen. Instead of retreating into comfort food, just pull out whatever looks good.
Yeah.
The way that I started my journey at Scarecrow way back in the day.
Right.
And I want to go back. I want to find that innocence again.
Oh.
You know, I don't know if it's possible. I think it's possible.
I think you can do it.
I think it'll be a gradual situation, but I think I can do it.
Cool.
So that's my New Year's resolution.
I don't know if I have one. As soon as I asked you what yours was, I was like, I don't even know.
You're very good. You watch new stuff all the time.
Maybe my resolution is to rewatch some old favorites. Could be a little flip-flop. Also, I have some ideas for some new segments and things we can do on the show as well.
Oh, I can't wait to hear about that.
That we can talk about off camera and that you guys will hopefully see in future episodes.
Mm-hmm.
But that kind of wraps up our like admin intro stuff for today. So do you want to like get into episode 70?
I absolutely do.
Mailbag.
We have a quickie mailbag for you this evening.
One that is special because look at it. It's a real mail bag.
It's a nice envelope. I like the Saturn. I like the little star.
Mm-hmm.
And this is a pretty card. wonder if you can see that. Put it up on Still Store Cambot.
I know what that means.
Yeah, I know you do. And this is from Sophia and Maverick.
Oh.
Oh, and also there's a little postcard in here for Gang Smashers. You know, maybe Kenny. Okay.
Dear Viva Physical Media, sorry I'm late with my end of the year list. I just wanted to make sure I didn't leave anything off. This year, my list is top 12 movies I saw in theaters in chronological order.
Crony Awards.
Number one, Strange Days, 35mm at the GI.
Oh, hell yeah.
Fucking cool.
Excellent.
Two, Gold Diggers of 1933, 35mm GI. Three, and when we say GI, we mean the Grand Illusion, for people who aren't in the know. Holy Mountain, DCP Sif Uptown, Titanic 4K Remaster, which I totally...
Kevin and I went and saw that.
4DX DCP Regal Meridian. Wait, first watch? Is that what that says?
Really? She'd never seen Titanic before?
I think that's what it says. And she saw it for the first time on the big screen?
That's beautiful.
That's amazing. I hope that's what that says.
I'm sad that probably Maverick couldn't have gone to the movies with her for that one.
God, he would have loved it.
He would have loved it.
Do you think there are any cats on the Titanic?
Yes.
Cool.
We won't go into what happened to them.
Yeah, they all went on the cat lifeboat.
Yeah.
Number five, Zodiac, 35mm GI. Six, Face Off, 35mm GI. Seven, Point Break, 4K Remastered, DCP GI. DCP GI. Eight, New York, New York, DCP The Beacon. Nine, Attack the Block, DCP Sif Egyptian. 10, Stop Making Sense. 40th Anniversary, DCP Sif Uptown. Dance the Whole Time. Awesome.
Cool.
11, The Hunger, DCP GI. 12, Near Dark, 35mm Sif Egyptian. You were there.
Yeah, I was there.
And you were there, and you were there. As a big Bigelow fan, it was incredible to see my favorite three movies of hers, and they're all also some of my favorites all time, in theaters. And also, here's a quick top five movies I rented from Scarecrow in order that I rented them. Number one, Moonlighting, 1982. Two, Used Cars. Nice. Three, Get on the Bus. Four, The One. Five, Ambulance.
Hell yeah.
Hell yeah. I'm also going to send a companion email with a photo of my cat Maverick's Halloween costume this year. I watched Fight Club for the first time and felt like he was my Tyler Durden. Specifically, the scenes near the end where the narrator was running into rooms yelling, "What are you doing? Put that down. Stop." I'm sure a familiar feeling for many pet owners. Sophia and Maverick. Thank you so much, Sophia. I love reading lists. Honestly,
we love all of your correspondence, by the way.
Yeah, very. Thank you.
Tremendous. And we love seeing Maverick and hearing about his hijinks.
Tyler Durden.
It's beautiful. And, I mean, congratulations on the Bigelow thing. I'm a big Bigelow fan as well.
Yeah.
So it's nice to have another
big head
into the circle. Another big head.
Another big boy.
Another Bigelowed.
If you guys want to send us mail, we would love to hear what you're thinking about watching this year. If you took a minute to get your lists together for last year, we would still love to read them. Or just kind of anything that's on your mind, what just movie-wise, whatever. viva@scarecrow.com. Or you can be like Sophia and give us some physical mail, either drop it by the store or send it to
5030 Roosevelt Way Northeast, Seattle, Washington 98105.
Yeah. Or you can also tweet at us at Physical Viva.
Yeah.
And that's a mailbag.
That's a what?
I think I see the content warning right over there.
The following segment contains frank discussion of adult themes. Viewer discretion is advised.
Happy New Year, perverts. I didn't get to talk about my best of 2023 last episode, so let me do it right now. Some nice horny picks that I loved last year was Passages, Love a Chaotic Bisexual, Poor Things, lots of sex, Emma Stone just taking the town, love it, and Saltburn. We all know the scene. Just slurp it up. So I love that Saltburn's making the rounds with a very famous dong that's been popping around. If you think you're getting away. which made me think of one of my favorite movies of all time. Shame. Shame, directed by Steve McQueen from 2011. I actually saw this movie when it came out in theaters. Side note, I was sitting next to a sex addict. It was a mirror, just kidding. So the movie is about Brandon. He's an executive living in New York who seems to have this very classy, independent lifestyle, but we quickly find out that he is addicted to sex. And he has a daily ritual of masturbating, using sex workers, watching a lot of porn. And you see this, like, this is a habit he has. And then his young sister, played by Carey Mulligan, who's great, comes and stays with him.
I fucking kill you! What the fuck?
Ow! Fuck!
Jesus Christ, sissy!
Fuck! Brandon, don't you fucking knock?
What the fuck? Why would I knock? I live here!
And his life quickly spirals out of control. This addiction that he has been hiding is no longer hidden. It's starting to bubbling. It's affecting his personal life, his family life.
Okay, me again. I'm dying.
Starts literally tearing him apart. I love this movie. It's very realistic depiction of sex addiction, which I want to disclaimer, like, there's nothing wrong with sex. There's nothing wrong with masturbating or using sex workers or watching pornography. Those are all fine in moderation. As we see in this movie, when you don't do that, shit goes wrong very quickly. You see how his sex life and his sex addiction affects him negatively, but it's called shame, but it's not really the shame about the sex addiction. It's actually a shame about how he feels about himself, his loneliness, his sadness.
What's your longest relationship? Exactly.
That's even poor. 4 months.
And how he just won't connect and deal with himself, and that he uses sex as a band-aid, basically. And that you see a lot of nudity, you see a lot of sex. Probably the unsexiest movie about sex that I've probably talked about so far. It's just very... Steve McQueen's famous for doing these really long takes, so you really see a lot of emotion during these long takes, and just... It's beautiful. I think it's Michael Fassbender's best performance. Karen Mulligan's great as well. I think it's Steve McQueen's best movie as well. Shot beautifully. I love the score. It's very moody. It's very melancholic. Very melancholy movie. Cannot fucking talk today. Melancholy. It's very melancholy. There's a beautiful scene where Carey Mulligan sings New York, New York that I really love.
Start spreading the news.
Michael Fassbender. Gorgeous, gorgeous man. You see a lot of him in this movie. It broke the internet. He made a lot of strides in male nudity for film. Good for you, Michael Fassbender. I approve. You and that massive dong. There's a famous hotel sex scene, which is actually in a real hotel in New York that's famous for all these windows and people have sex. And you can see them from the street. And side note, a couple died doing that. So don't do that. Don't go to New York and find this hotel and fuck in it because you'll die. Maybe.
How'd they die? Against the window.
The window gave way. Yeah, it's a movie about control, self-destruction, using sex as escapism, self-hatred, and just loneliness and sadness. It's a bummer. It's a beautiful movie, but it's also a bummer. I don't think I want to watch it again for another 13 years, honestly. But my memory held up really well as I rewatched it. It's just so vivid and it's just so realistic. I feel like sex addiction in a lot of media and film is played for laughs. It's not taken seriously, or you're like, oh, that's your problem. You have too much sex. But this, I feel like, really digs deep into how it could ruin your life if it gets out of control. He's a little predatory in this movie when he's starting kind of like chasing women around, like it just kind of gets a little scary. And there are some scary situations. There is a little bit of self-harm in the movie as well. A little trigger warning for you. I think I like this movie because it shows that no matter the facade of someone's life, you never know what's bubbling beneath, especially when it comes to sex. And he kind of judges other people's sexuality in the movie, and it's quickly thrown back in his face that he should not be the judge of other people, especially what he does. I give it 5 out of 5, punches to the face.
Your hard drive is filthy, right? We got your computer back. I mean, it is dirty. I'm talking like hoes, sluts, anal, double anal, penetration, interracial, facial, man, cream pie. I don't even know what that is.
Ding. Ding.
Ding.
Ding. It's time for another installment of...
Was someone ringing the dinner bell, or is it Raunch versus Rom? Yes, it's been a while, but we've tallied the votes, and I have a winner from last time. If you recall, which I don't, we had Fools Rush In.
That's right.
And then we had...
I don't remember what you did.
Teen Lust Girl Next Door.
Yes!
Which, its title sounds like a porn. That got 5 votes, and Fools Rush In got 11. So thank you guys for voting. Obviously, it was... I agree.
Bit of a ringer, but I didn't do that on purpose.
Yeah, and Teen Lust Girls Next Door sucks, so...
I have a bit of a ringer this time, but I don't think it's going to win.
Mine sucks, and I think that yours is going to win.
Oh my God. Well, you and I can have a competition about which one of these is worse.
And it's mine, because no matter what, people love yours.
Maybe we can disabuse them of that. Anyway, we'll see.
All right. So you guys know the rules. We each talk about the movies in our corner, and then we get 2 minutes, and then we do final closing arguments, and then you guys vote until the next time we decide to do Raunch versus Rom, then we announce the winner.
Mm-hmm.
So who do we have in my corner of the ring? In my corner of the ring, my contender is the VHS-only Grad Night.
Ooh.
Rad Grads Gone Mad.
That rhymes.
1980. John Tenobrio Jr. And who we got in your corner?
Oh, I have the beloved by many, many a folk, but never seen by me until now. Never been kissed.
Amazing. All right, so I will start off with Grad Night.
3, 2, 1, go.
Grad Night, 1980, directed by John Tenorio Jr.
Whatever.
He only directed or wrote this alone. This is basically a somewhat lifeless rendition of American Graffiti and a shittier version of what was to come with Fast Times at Ridgemont High. It is grad night and everyone's ready to party.
Mm.
Except it takes a while to get to the partying. But MacArthur High School, people are cruising. People are getting drunk. People are drunk driving. Nerds are drinking at the beach. There's a couple who's constantly fighting, and they'll definitely break up by the end of the movie. There's a teacher who's hooking up with a student. So sexy.
Wait a minute.
Hold on. Anyway. There is, I don't know. There's a running gag with a streaker who keeps showing up. We don't get any boobs until almost the end when they go to this bar. And outside the bar, the sign on the bar is called Haunted House Bar. And I was so excited.
I was stoked,
like, what the fuck is this going to be? It was nothing. It was like an empty barn and with a stripper in the corner. And we barely see her boobs. so that made me upset. There's this girl named Virginia who flashes her naked body under her grad gown at the podium. And then there's a big dance floor brawl. But it really... You know, it kind of falls flat. I was hoping to get some more raunch in there. It was very promising. Rad Grads Gone Mad. Get ready for the maddest cap and gown celebration of the year.
It's madcap.
But it was kind of just, you know. But it was one of those things where I was like, okay, I bet all these guys are friends. It was filmed in Sacramento. There was some kind of cool Elton John-esque music playing that we had the soundtrack. I'm not quite sure who it was, but yeah, that's grad night. Last day at MacArthur High.
3, 2, 1, go.
1999's Never Been Kissed, directed by Roger Gosnell, starring the beloved Drew Barrymore. Now, this movie is very well liked by a certain cohort of young people. I haven't seen this movie until very recently. Yeah. I had never seen this before when it came out. I was in my 20s when this came out. I was like 21 in 1999. Anyway, it stars Drew Barrymore. Like all romantic comedy women, she works for a newspaper or a magazine. In this case, it's the Chicago Sun-Times. She wants to be a reporter, but she's a copy editor. Gary Marshall, the boss of the newspaper, decides inexplicably for no apparent reason to send her undercover to a high school to report on what young people really feel these days. So she goes back to high school, pretends to be a 17-year-old when she's really 27. In the meantime, she starts to develop an inappropriate but not physical relationship with her English teacher, Michael Vartan, who doesn't know she's an adult woman, so that makes it okay. In order to get all of the other students to like her, she convinces her brother, David Arquette, to pretend to be a student as well and talk about how cool she is. He develops a relationship that we don't see as physical but know that it is with a 16-year-old girl, but she doesn't know he's a grown-up, so that makes it okay. At the end of the movie, everybody in Chicago is invested in a teacher seducing his student and publicly expressing a display of affection now that he knows she's a grown-up, and the entire city thinks that that is now okay. There's also a surveillance guy hired by the newspaper to keep track of what Drew Barrymore is doing. They body cam her while she is pretending to be a young woman in a high school, photographing all the other students without their consent, and that's okay. There's a lot of interesting nebulous aspects of this movie. I wish I had seen it when I was in my 20s as opposed to an old man.
Wow. So now we have our final closing statements, just like one last thing we want to say that will help us win this amazing contest
of two movies we both really liked.
So one closing thing, they do have an old school tampon machine in this movie that someone had painted the words "the curse" on the side of, which I thought was very fun indeed. And then at one point a sex worker toasts a young boy trying to get her to have sex with him and says at the bar, "Here's looking at you, kid."
Classic.
And I was like, a movie. That's a movie.
A movie we could all really sit down and watch.
Yeah.
My closing argument is that this also has a triumvirate of Mean Girls, Jordan Ladd, Jessica Alba, Marley Shelton, who are constantly scantily clad and treated like stupid bitches. And again, that's okay. So enjoy Never Been Kissed. I wish that I had encountered this as a 20-year-old as opposed to a 45-year-old man. It hits a little different.
All right, we're getting into the meat and potatoes of the episode.
What's titles, precious?
God, why?
Potatoes?
I know, but why do all boys do that voice?
I don't know. I can't.
And the other one.
Which one?
Yeah, that one.
Our Mortrad.
Yeah, that fucking one. Yeah, that's exactly what I'm talking about.
I can recommend a little Marvel, dude.
I hate it so much. All right, moving on to something I don't hate that I really love. The movie EXISTENZ by David Cronenberg. This movie fucking rules. David Cronenberg, 1999. I feel like this isn't talked about enough. This movie is the best. Actually, I don't know why I'm not showing the new Vinegar Syndrome.
That new 4K? Does it look good? Did you watch that?
Yeah, but I don't have a 4K player or a 4K TV.
So you watched the new Blu-ray.
But I watched the new Blu-ray and it looks really great. So this is starring Baby Jude Law and Jennifer Jason Leigh, both faves. And we're introduced to that it's the year 2030 and we're at a gaming conference. And Jennifer Jason Leigh is the hottest, coolest, best game developer ever.
I give you the GamePod goddess herself, Allegra Geller.
And Jude Law is a security guard, kind of. Then he's also like I don't think he's a journalist, maybe like a publicist type. I don't know. He's there, but he's not really into it, but he's there because he has to be.
They told me you're my security, but you have no weaponry.
Who told you that? I'm just a marketing trainee.
And everyone is volunteering to get ported up to go into this virtual reality game, this hot new game called EXISTENZ, which is basically like a Second Life where you, it's kind of like Total Recall-esque. And the way you get ported up is you have a bioport that's on the bottom of your spine, like above your butt crack, and it looks like a butthole. And you gotta lube that baby up, and you gotta get stuck in to a port device, which looks like a pound of flesh.
It's a big yucky thing. Yeah.
And it's kind of like almost like a living, breathing thing. It's kind of like an umbilical cord that goes into your bioport. And once you get hooked up, you're in the game, and it feels exactly like real life.
Just like me.
It's kind of like the holodeck in, you know, Next Generation. Mm-hmm. There's so many different examples of what it could be. But at this conference, when everyone's getting ready to hook up into EXISTENZ, there's an attempted assassination on Allegra Geller by this guy who snuck in a gun because the gun was made of flesh and the bullets were teeth.
It's gut guns.
Death to the demoness Allegra Geller. No!
It's a really cool looking gun, though. It's very awesome. He doesn't successfully assassinate her, but now Jude Law and Jennifer Jason Leigh are on the run, basically. And she, all the while, is like, I think my game is messed up. I think EXISTENZ got damaged during this, and so we need to both play it together in order to make sure the integrity of the game is still good. But Jude Law doesn't have a bioport. He's been kind of like, I don't know about this, as one would be.
Mm-hmm. I don't know. Can't do it. It's too freaky. Makes my skin crawl.
But he eventually decides to get one. He gets one by this back alley bioport installation expert named Gas, who is played by Willem Dafoe.
And he's called Gas because he works at a gas station.
He works at an auto shop gas station where he also does bioports.
The one thing you don't want to do is mess with the stud finder.
But he gives him a fucked up bioport, things go wrong, and basically it's all these different levels of reality while it's also them like running away from these bad guys called the realists. They want people to live in the real world, which is bad. This movie rules. It's cool because it's like video games reality, but like what are bodies? What is reality? How are we connected? Do we have to be physically connected to like this earthly realm? What is being connected? It's like body horror meets nerdy virtual reality, like Cyber Zone. And I love it. And it's really fun. It's like 93 minutes long. It's like a real short one. Yeah. And it's, if you're a Cronenberg fan, you're going to love it. Jennifer Jason Leigh is great in it. It's just, it's a lot of fun. And it's also really gross. And I think it's great. So if you haven't yet, or if it's been a while, watch EXISTENZ.
Okay, so on our last episode, I picked this one as one of my favorite physical media releases of 2023. It is the Criterion release of The Last Picture Show, but the reason I picked it, and what I promised you I would talk about this time, was the bonus feature on this, which is the director's cut, remastered in black and white, of Bogdanovich's sequel to The Last Picture Show, also based on the Larry McMurtry novel, TEXASVILLE.
This is KAUZ Channel 6, Wichita Falls, Texas.
TEXASVILLE is so tonally different from The Last Picture Show, but also just as affecting and bittersweet and sad. You know, if you remember The Last Picture Show, that's kind of a movie about these young people being trapped by the nostalgia and the expectations of them placed on them by the past, and kind of how they rebel against that and how they fail to rebel against it. And some of them sort of end up trapped in this tiny town that they long to escape. TEXASVILLE picks up many, many, many years later with some of the same characters. Jeff Bridges is back as Dwayne, Timothy Bottoms is back, and Sam has taken over Ben Johnson's character from the first movie, his businesses, and still operates the convenience store. Jeff Bridges' character has struck oil, and he's gotten rich off oil, but the oil industry is declining, and so the town, even though there's a lot of old money left in the town, the sort of economy of the place has declined yet again.
I might as well let that oil stay where it is. Not going to bring it up just to give it away.
And then into this, returns the Sybil Shepherd character from the first movie, JC, who has gone on to become kind of a famous actress.
You certainly have a dull attitude towards television. What's the point of it if you're not going to speculate about the sex lives of people on game shows?
But has also suffered the damage of some personal tragedies of her own and has kind of come back to the small town just to recover and kind of figure out what she wants to do next. And all of these characters sort of swirl around together and not just recall what their previous sort of versions of themselves were like.
I know I flirted a little, but that's just my nature. Actually, I guess it's just the ghost of my nature.
But contemplate a future that is rapidly hurtling at them. You know, they're not young anymore. The future seemed unknowable and full of potential, even though they were miserable without it in the first place. And now they feel like they've maybe have squandered a lot of that potential, but don't know where they want to go next.
Did I have you madly in love?
Madly.
Guess I once could summon some pretty mad love.
You know, whereas The Last Picture Show was more bleak and more sort of about the sort of stultifying circumstances of their lives, this is a lot more humorous, a lot more bittersweet. It's a lot more about getting older and reconciling the version of yourself that is current with the version of yourself that you thought you might become. You know, Jeff Bridges' character is a bit of a womanizer still.
I don't think I can fit in through this window.
Shoot, I told Junior we needed a station wagon.
But also,
he is Jeff Bridges,
kind of sanguine about that whole thing. The Timothy Bottoms character is struggling with his mental health in a way that wasn't really apparent in the original film.
Maybe I have a brain tumor.
No, I don't think you do.
There's all kinds of little circumstances that have complicated everything. What's most interesting about this for me is how bittersweet and funny it is. It's more of a comedy than the original in a lot of respects. And it's also just gorgeous. I mentioned on the last episode that they have turned this into black and white to make it more aligned aesthetically with the original film. It's also Bogdanovich's longer director's cut of the movie, so about 25 minutes longer. It's really spectacular. MVP also Annie Potts as Jeff Bridges' current wife, who is not a character in the original film, but is so funny in this.
Just because you're having a midlife crisis, I don't think you ought to try and shoot your dick off.
Why not? It don't work half the time anyway.
Well, I wouldn't be the one to know about that. But it's a small target, and if you miss, you're going to ruin our new hot tub.
It also features some other characters from the old movie, like Randy Quaid comes back.
What a life. My wife's about to bear you a grandchild. Your old girlfriend's about to bear me a child. And unless I'm very lucky, I'm headed for prison.
It's really, really sweet and funny. And it's one of those 90s movies that I think snuck past people because it doesn't have the cachet, you know, the 1970s golden era movie brat period of Last Picture Show or things like Taxi Driver, things that, you know, we all associate with classic 70s films. TEXASVILLE kind of slid under the radar. I know when I was a kid and, I was certainly old enough to have seen TEXASVILLE when it came out, but I wasn't interested. I didn't care. Mm-hmm. As an adult, now it hits really differently. It seems very relevant. I think it's generally underseen by all. And so I highly recommend that you check it out. And if you do, please make sure you watch this version that's on the new Criterion Last Picture Show 4K.
I gotta do that.
Man. No thanks, I'm on a fast.
Fast?
You know, when you starve yourself for calm.
Yeah, what cause are you starving yourself for?
The all cause. I'm fasting for an embargo on foreign all. I ain't on the real fast yet, I'm just practicing with these Fruit Loops.
All right, now we're gonna get into some real violent shit.
The nitty and the gritty?
The nitty and the gritty. Mm. Because I don't know about you.
Oh, hell yeah.
But I wanna talk about Bone Tomahawk. I didn't know where I was going with that. This movie's fucked up, you guys. This movie's so good. 2015, directed by S. Craig Zahler, who has done some other cool shit like Brawl and Cellblock 99, mm-hmm. Dragged Across Concrete, which I still haven't seen, but will shortly, etc., etc.
It's something. It's really great.
This was his first. This is his directorial debut, and it is a hyper-violent Western, kind of a rescue Western with the little tinges of horror here and there, I think.
Little tinges.
Well, it's all horrifying, but then I guess I'm talking about like supernaturally horror stuff.
Oh no, I just meant like when there's horror in this, it's fucking horrible.
Oh yeah. Yeah, it's horrifying. So basically the sheriff, Kurt Russell, looking great, pals are investigating this weird drifter, David Arquette.
Are you carrying a weapon? A gun? Knife? Letter opener with a sharp point? Dynamite?
Who is also moonlighting as a high schooler at Drew Barrymore's workspace.
Look, he operates the Tiki post office for some reason.
Yeah, but he's so good at baseball.
Yeah.
Thanks, Coach Romano.
So David Arquette's like drinking at this bar, and he had just seen a bunch, the murder of like Sid Haig and some other people.
Do you hear that?
That was a gust.
That's a real musical gust.
And?
It's ominous.
So they're investigating this murder, and they're realizing that it might be this demonic, cannibal, scary, inbred tribe that lives in the caves.
You'll take us to them?
I won't.
Because you're an Indian?
Because I don't want to get killed.
You're afraid of your own kind?
They're not my kind. They're a spoiled bloodline of inbred animals who rape and eat their own mothers.
The cast is great in this. This is the second time I've watched this. Patrick Wilson's performance is my favorite. He is an injured dude whose wife is the doctor.
Tell me here and tell me plain.
Mrs. O'Dwyer was abducted.
His wife gets kidnapped along with the like co-deputy and David Arquette. And so basically Kurt Russell and Matthew Fox and Richard Jenkins all get together to go rescue these people. And Patrick Wilson comes too, even though they're like, you should really stay home because your legs are fucked up. And he's like, no, I have to get my wife. And his whole performance in this is very like, he's so driven to get to his wife that you see this guy can't catch a fucking break. Like besides the break in his leg is all broken. And every time he stands up for something, he'll just like fall down a cliffside. He'll get in a fight. It'll snap more.
Oh, Jesus, goddamn.
It just gets progressively worse and worse and more infected and more infected, and he refuses to get it amputated.
That's how I feel whenever I get up or sit down.
It's this journey of these guys into the mountains, into the caves, to try to find these what they call troglodytes so that they can get their friends back, even though everything that they start to discover about this tribe is more and more terrifying. They're eating people. They have this really bizarre sound they make in their weird voice boxes.
Is that jewelry?
That at one point Patrick Wilson like digs out this piece of the throat so he can have a call for them, which is really fucked up. Hijinks ensue, you know what I mean? And they make it there, and you know, I don't want to like spoil the end of the movie, but we do have the pleasure of seeing someone get bisected. Oh! And it's just it's if you're like into violence and gore, and also this is just a really well done movie. Mm-hmm. It's an amazing Western. I like my Westerns a little messed up, a little scary, and this it checks all the boxes. Also, Kurt Russell's amazing in it. But yeah, Patrick Wilson's performance is the one that really got me this time around. It is quite the film, quite the little movie. So if you haven't seen it and you're into any of the things I described and you're not like running away the other way screaming, check out Bone Tomahawk.
Rich, were you at Fantastic Fest in 2015 for that?
Yeah,
I mean, like,
I would have loved to see it.
If you've ever been to Fantastic Fest, like sitting in a giant theater with a bunch of horror folks who are not squeamish, and then you watch something like this, and then you watch 600 horror fans who aren't squeamish lose their minds because of something that's just so fucked up that it hit even them.
Yeah.
This has one of those scenes.
I would have loved to see this on the big screen.
This was closing night that year too. So people were just like ready to get like go to the party, and then this happened and they're like, oh fuck no.
It's awesome. So good. Yeah. So Bone Tomahawk.
And not just because you're prettier than most cows.
Most.
You never saw Jessica.
Okay, so I encountered this movie just the other day when a friend of ours, Laird, asked me if I'd seen it.
And you said no?
And I said no, but I tracked it down right away and watched it immediately because it sounded amazing. And it is called Charlie Victor Romeo. This movie is based on a play, and it is a filmed play, the movie. And the play is five individual segments that are reenacted transcripts of black box recordings from five different plane crashes.
Good luck on your landing there, Captain.
Hello.
Were you looking for me?
Yeah, we just got the message. It's going to be real bumpy on the way down the landing.
Okay.
So you might want to pack it all up, whatever, as soon as we start down.
And basically what you see is a kind of like a couple of different angles on in the cockpit where actors who play the pilots and co-pilots are reenacting the circumstances that led to a plane crash. And some of the plane crashes are tragic and others have happier endings. However, what you are seeing is pure anti-cinema. You ever see Dogville? You know how Dogville is like basically nothing around them? This is the same thing. Like there's some computers in the background and a couple of people sitting in chairs with some steering.
That movie didn't make me feel great either.
Exactly. This is just a really intense sort of existential experience. I'm not certain that anyone's going to get more out of this than I did, but I found the technical jargon and the technical aspects of what's happening really fascinating.
Set and armed. VR is right on track.
Okay.
Gears down in green. Spoiler lever.
Armed.
You got brakes are going to medium.
It might help if you choose to watch this, as I was advised to do, to look at the Wikipedia entries for the individual incidents so that you actually do know what
context.
Is happening, because the movie doesn't tell you. You only get the information of the people speaking and talking to the tower on the radio. It doesn't specify, here's what is happening right now.
And these are actual, like, what they would be the actual calls?
They are the actual transcripts of real crashes that did happen.
And 911 calls really fuck me up.
Yeah, it's really intense. And
even though I just talked about a guy getting bisected, this is worse.
Well, this has, you know, its fingers in reality in a different way. It's a really fascinating piece of work. To me, it kind of represented this idea of all of this meticulous preparation and detail and technical proficiency cannot stave off the inevitable. It's a little bit existentially dark.
Yeah.
It's a fascinating experiment. If you find this kind of rough formalism interesting, I guarantee that you'll enjoy it. If you're like me and you have a kind of a tech fetish and you're curious about how these things operate and what kind of procedures take place in situations like this, again, equally fascinating. But there's also this element of it that is completely unknowable and unconfrontable. Nothing can be done. You see people following their procedures to the letter, doing exactly what they know they should do.
What reads there?
Auto throttle disconnect, rotor ratio, box speed indicator.
Okay.
500 feet, it's grabbing now. These assholes from maintenance move everything!
What should have they done?
But maybe one piece of information is escaping them for whatever reason, or some piece of technology isn't functioning in the most minute way and it leads to disaster, and there's nothing anybody could have done to fix it. It's existentially terrifying in a way that extends beyond the mere possibility of, am I gonna die in a car crash or a plane crash? Mm. It's equally fascinating, hypnotic, and deeply, deeply disturbing. I was really surprised by it. This Blu-ray that we just got in this week, apparently this movie was filmed in 3D, but I didn't watch it in 3D, but you can if this comes with glasses.
Okay.
So have fun. In the meantime, yeah, enjoy Charlie Victor Romeo and watch five plane crashes in real time.
We're going to have the gear down. And if we can keep the airplane on the ground and stop standing up, give us a second or two before you evacuate. Brace will be the signal, be over the PA system. Brace, brace, brace.
And that'll be to evacuate.
That'll be to brace for landing.
We have a really good dog movie, I think.
Very sweet one. And you were the one who
picked
it.
This is my pick. It is 2005's Cave of the Yellow Dog. A German film made in Mongolia.
Directed by B.M. Basurin Dawa.
Mm-hmm. And this is kind of a hybrid documentary narrative.
Yeah, because the family in this is a real family.
It's a real family. They're Mongolian nomadic goat herders.
And these kids are so
beautiful.
Cute! Oh my gosh. Yes. It's a mother and a father and their three children, and their oldest daughter's probably only like six.
Nonsal.
And then there's a little like 3 or 4 year old girl. I don't remember her name. And then the baby who's like two. Kind of just goes through their life as nomadic sheep farmers.
We see the sort of the details of their day-to-day life, their work. The mother is constantly doing laundry or making cheese from the goats.
She's sewing a dress for her daughter because she sends her daughter away to school for like half of the year in the city
to stay with their uncle.
Yeah.
Yeah.
The main issue is that there are wolves that are coming in and killing their sheep. So father is selling the sheepskin in the city. So he goes away for a while. Mm-hmm. While he's away, the eldest daughter has to kind of step up.
Mm-hmm. So she has to go out with the horse and kind of wrangle the goats.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And she finds a dog in a cave. Little cave.
And the dog's name is Zokor, which means spot.
Oh, I didn't know that. That's very cute.
And he has a big black spot on his back.
Yeah, but her parents are like, you can't
have it. Especially the dad is like, you cannot keep this dog.
But she's kind of just always like, no, I'm going to keep this dog. And then they just like kind of keep the dog.
Yeah.
But she does go out to do her father's duties while he is gone, and she loses Zokar. She can't find him.
She gets lost herself.
And then she gets lost.
Yeah.
And then there's a storm.
Yes. And she takes shelter with an old lady.
Yeah, who tells her the story of the Cave of the Yellow Dog.
The father has an ailing daughter, and he puts a dog in a cave in order
to... The
dog that they love in order to sort of like be a good omen and heal his daughter.
Yeah.
Like it's a sacrifice.
It's a sacrifice. It's like, what do you really need and what matters most? The little girl's like, well, do you think I'm going to come back as a person in the next life? Is any rice balancing on the needle head? And she's like, no, that's impossible. That's how impossible it is to come back as a human. So you got to make this life count. Eventually, her mom gets her.
Yeah, I mean, everything's
fine. And
they
find the dog, too.
The dog was asleep.
The dog's always snoozing somewhere.
Yeah, there's a repeated motif where the little girl is trying to play with Zokor, and she's like, you're always asleep when I want to play.
Yeah, at the end of the movie, she's like, I think you were a lazy bones in a previous life. It was very cute. I feel like these kids are just improvising it.
I think the whole thing is mostly here's what we are doing today. Like, enact this the way that you would live your life.
Right, and then we're gonna have this like dog subplot.
Yeah,
you know,
the family, because they're nomadic, they, you know, the seasons are changing. They need to move on to a different environment, different climate. So they start to pack up, and they put their yurt.
I loved watching them disassemble the yurt.
Oh my god, that was amazing.
Really cool.
Well, the best thing, I mean, there's a lot of neat stuff about this movie, but the best thing about it is just watching the processes of their lives.
Yeah.
And how intricate and how specific all of their plans
need to be. And how they just handle all of it.
I really like watching, say, the mother do what she needs to do, like with her children, and enlist them to kind of help her do it, because you can see she's starting to educate them. Like, this is what your lives are going to be.
Yeah.
This is what we need you to know how to do.
And when she goes out to find her eldest daughter, she leaves the two youngest alone. And that's really cute.
Yeah.
They're just like jumping on the bed and like punching each other and playing with different figurines.
It's great.
It's very sweet.
There's a part in this too when they get a furry pink motorized dog toy, and the dog toy is making this barking noise, but it's a squeak. And that squeak sounds exactly like the squeaker in Lily's toys.
Oh, no.
And
was
so
she like...
Lily woke up and was wandering around the apartment, sniffing all her different toys to figure out what was making the squeaking sound.
Oh, no.
It was very funny. They're packing up all of their belongings.
Dad's
in their
saying
hut.
Dog needs to stay.
Yeah. And they tie the dog to a post.
I hated that.
Yeah, I didn't like that either. But they put the youngest son in a basket. But the little girl gets distracted by the fact that she's not going to be able to bring her dog with her. And she's sad. Meanwhile, the little boy escapes from his little crib.
He just toddles out.
And the family leaves without him, not knowing that they've left him behind.
Dude, I didn't even realize he was going to be left behind. And
then there was like, there's like where's Bot Buyer?
Yeah, there's like, where's the baby?
The dad has to rush back to get him. And when he gets there, the baby is just kind of wandering around.
Just like laughing and
shit. Is about to get eaten by vultures.
Because there's like six or seven or more.
More giant vultures.
They're huge.
And they're eating some goat carcass or something.
Yeah, and the baby's just literally just like laughing and wandering
She's
over.
Like, whoa, look at these birds.
And the dog
gets free
and runs and barks at the vultures to make them...
Scares them away.
Yeah, and basically saves the baby.
And the dad sees that and is like, okay, you can stay.
I didn't know at first, though, because he starts to like go off. And the dog keeps like sitting and waiting behind. And I was like, great, he's not gonna like. But then there was a reveal shot where it's showing their little caravan. And then it shows the oldest girl with the dog in one of the baskets.
Yeah.
And then it does a cute thing at the end where it shows each person in like a little like,
all their,
not like a blooper, but they're like laughing
it's
and
like
stuff.
It's like a photo call credit.
Yeah.
There's a nice little moment at the very end of this too, where they're going off to where, you know, wherever their new location will be. And there's a truck going by in the other direction talking about how everybody needs to vote in the new election, which was like a slight thread throughout the movie. There's a couple of points where the mom asks the dad who's been to town and come back, like what went on with the election? Oh, well, they're restaging it because there was some weirdness, things like that. And I think it all just generally adds up to this idea of maybe let's take stock of what's valuable to us now and impermanence and just sort of like you only have this one chance to do something with your life. And, you know, what is important to you? Is it this larger thing or is it the smaller thing?
Is it a plastic ladle that's going to melt in the oil?
That was so cool.
They're like, oh, shoot. And then they just used it to, like, feed the dog afterwards.
I like that, too, because he gives it to her and she's like, is this heat resistant? And then he's like, I don't know. And then a couple scenes later, the little girl is like, Mom, the thing's melting in the pot. Yeah. It's a really, really sweet movie. And I love the documentary hybrid aesthetic to it.
I loved watching these kids. They were so funny and so sweet and adorable. And the dog was great. It wasn't much of a narrative thing, but...
Yeah, it doesn't have a ton of conflict.
Until the very end.
It's the second time I've seen it. I loved it more this time. I'm going to give it 4 paws.
I'm going to give it 3.5 just because it didn't pull me emotionally as much as some other ones have. But I did really like it, and I definitely recommend it. But you know what's going to really pull me emotionally?
Tell me.
Our next dog movie.
Oh, yeah. What is it?
Marmaduke.
Hell yeah.
Marmaduke, you guys. It had to happen.
Marmaduke, Mama Luke.
I've never seen it, but we got it with Wilson.
Apparently, there's a CGI kitty in it, too.
Thank God.
From Tom Day, the director of Shanghai Noon.
Oh, I mean, and that's all I really need to hear. You know
Lee Pace.
Mean? Okay.
Kiefer Sutherland.
Dude.
Sam Elliott. Steve Coogan. I'm just reading the back of the thing.
That's crazy. Okay. Well, we will come back talking about the funniest tale on Blu-ray next time.
I'm gonna be after I got your team.
After I got your job.
The other way is not the key.
Awesome, Bashu. Awesome, Bashu.
Then I'm gonna get back.
Episode 70 in the bag.
Boom.
In the bucket. We're done.
The fuck it bucket.
The first episode of 2024. I hope you guys enjoyed it.
Happy New Year.
I did.
Thank you for helping us meet our fundraising goal.
Yeah.
Thank you for everything that you do to support Scarecrow Video, whether it's watch this show, like and subscribe on our YouTube channel, follow us on social media, rent a movie, donate, whatever you do to support Scarecrow it's a tremendous help, and it means a lot to us. And you're helping keep physical media alive and all of our vast catalog available to you all over the country.
Yes, and remember, you can rent by mail if you go to our website, no matter where you are, if you're in the country, at least.
Yes, the continental United States.
Cool, so just tune in next time for episode 71. In the meantime, like this, subscribe, comment, email us at viva@scarecrow.com. Come visit us in the store and follow us on all the socials.
And remember
vote
to
for Raunch versus Rom.
That's right.
Please vote. And that is all.
Bye.
Goodbye.
Beyond the edge of civilization.